Of Zion, weep no more. Pack your bags, we're going home. Shake off your captivity. Today's the day we shall be free. Bye, 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 bye. Bye, bye.
Saints are rising, praise and cry, and one day in Good morning, church family. It's great to see you. Happy Labor Day. Oh, what an exciting weekend we have today, this weekend. It's great to see those of you on our campus, 415 North Main Street, and welcome those of you watching online. Thank you so much for joining us. If everybody could, take your card that's right in front of you. Fill that out. It's a great way for us to stay connected. If you are a first-time guest, welcome. We're so glad you've come today. If you could take that card and when the service is over, stop by Starting Point out in the atrium foyer area. We have a gift we'd like to give you just to say thanks for coming. If you're watching online, please register your attendance with us as well. Thank you in advance for doing that. There are great things going on in the life of the church family. Go to the website, their church app. You will see all of those. We'll talk about a few of those later at the end of our service, but make sure you go to the church website. You will see everything that's going on. Part of what we do when we come together for worship is we declare with our mouths what we believe in our hearts. We come to say all praise to God the Father and Christ the Son and Holy Spirit. I will never be ashamed of the gospel. I'm going to lift my voice in worship, and I'm going to live a life for the glory of God. That's what we do when we gather for worship. Let's stand as we declare, I believe.
Crucifixion, by his blood I have been set free. I believe in the resurrection. Hallelujah, his life is destined. All praise to God the Father. All praise to Christ the Son. All praise to the Holy Spirit. Our God has overcome.
Our God has overcome the kingdom.
always worthy of our worship. Let's sing together and raise a hallelujah in His presence.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody.
Because we're more than conquerors. Those that stood in the Roman arena, they were conquerors. But you've given us power that we're more than that. You've allowed us to overcome sin, not because of our own power, our own strength, because we fall flat, but because of the blood that covers us through your Son, Jesus. That's why we gather here, is to celebrate that. Father, you loved us that much. You want us to be with you. And we've got no other choice but to be with you because we love you. But give us the strength to fight the battles. You haven't bound your enemy yet. So the battles are real. The battles hurt. They smell bad. They're frightening to look at. You give us the power through your Son, Jesus. Father, help us to rely on that power. Thank you for the Spirit that you give us, that counsels us through all kinds of strangeness, things we don't understand, so that we can be righteous with you. Father, there are a bunch of people that are hurting here. All of us are. And this past week, we've fallen short of your glory. But your grace is bigger than that. Your grace is the artillery again in this battle. That's how magnanimous you are. Father, thank you for calling us to your side. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Good morning, everyone. So good to see each and every one of you here today on this weekend, vacation, but it's good to see so many folks here. I want to thank the Vandenbosches for being with us today. They were so involved in our foster care ministry. They're vacationing here from Tennessee. Alan Cameo, great to have you here. All right, so fall's in the air. Can you feel a little bit of it? I did yesterday. I actually sat on the porch and didn't melt to the chair. So I was like, hey, I can feel the fall in the air. What we love about fall is pumpkin latte everything, right? Pumpkin everything. But football season is in full swing. Isn't that great? Yes. Oh, you got to love football, right? And something I've noticed during football season, after a game, especially a big game, the coach will bring everybody in the locker room, and they do a game ball every week. They choose a player and highlight that player because that player did something tremendous during the game and actually helped swing the game their direction. And so what I thought we would do is every Sunday between now and the playoffs is we're just gonna highlight a ministry. We're gonna give that ministry a game ball. And this is a ministry I wanna focus on just real quickly today. It's called the Helping Hands Ministry. Dane Smith, who's one of our elders, kicked this off about a year ago. Group of ladies and guys getting together and helping our older folks, our widows, with some upkeep around their home. And they have been on a mission since this ministry started, servicing a number of our folks in our church. And so Dane, want to thank you. Are you here right now, Dane? Would you stand? And we want to thank you and your team for doing a great job. Hold on. That's terrible. Yeah, I was going to throw it to Tony, but he's a UK grad, and I knew for sure he'd drop it. So, Dane, here we go. It's all yours, man. All right, there you go. All right. Thank you for your ministry. Hey, if you're interested in signing up or you need some help. Now, these guys don't add additions onto homes, all right? But they are willing to help wherever they can, and it's a blessing. And our church is better because of this team. All right. All right, we're going to plow through week number two of Run, Jonah, Run. All right, last week, we get a guy, a prophet of God, prophet of God. God says, you know what? Nineveh needs a preacher. And Jonah goes, yeah, they do, but I don't want to be that preacher. And God says, you're going to be that preacher. And he's like, nah, I really don't want to do that. And so God says, you're going to go and you're going to preach to Nineveh, and I want to spare that city. Well, Jonah was a prophet of God in Israel. And really what he wanted to do was focus his energy there. So he wanted to save them. And God said, well, look here, if we can save Nineveh, the people of Israel will see them and realize they can change too. But I think Jonah really wanted Nineveh to get it. And I mean get it hard. And he thought that negativity would filter into Israel and they would change. They would change. And so God says, I want you to get on a boat, head to Nineveh, I want you to preach. So he gets on a boat, right? He gets on a boat. But he goes the other direction. Check it out. Jonah, the first chapter, real quick. Verse 4, he's on a boat heading the wrong direction. And a great wind, verse 4, Jonah 1, of the sea, mighty tempest, took the ship and almost broke it apart. All right. And then we find in verse 14, the sailors are nervous. Everybody's like, what are we going to do? And they throw the cargo over and the storm just gets greater. And then they realize, you know what? I think the problem is one of the tourists on the boat's the reason why we got a problem. Therefore, they cried to the Lord and said, we pray, O Lord, verse 14, don't let us perish with this guy's life. He's the reason why we got the storm. He's the reason we're all going to die on this boat. And they said, don't let us perish with this man's life. And do not charge us with this innocent blood, for you, O Lord, have done as it has pleased you. So they picked Jonah up and threw him overboard. And he volunteered to go. What did I say last week? Got to honor this guy. You know, very few people are going to walk into the office Tuesday and go, hey, everybody, can I have your attention? I finally realize why there's so much disharmony and hatred in the office. It's me. You know how many guys need to walk into their homes, sit all their kids down and their wife and go, hey, I know our family's facing tremendous adversity. I know the toxicity in our house is so thick you could cut it with a knife. I think I found out the problem. It's me. Of course, the wife would have a heart attack. Kids would fall over and die themselves. You know why? Because they are waiting for you, whoever you are, we are, to finally take responsibility. And I got to tell you what, Jonah's been a heel up till now. Run from God, almost caused these guys to die. And he says, you know what? I'm the source of your problem. If you get rid of me, things are gonna work out. So I'm not asking for anybody here to be thrown overboard. Don't get me wrong. But I would love to know that we had people over the next 4 weeks as we go through this series to do some inventory and ask yourself this question. Is the turmoil in the church, the turmoil at home, the toxicity at the office have something to do with me? And if so, at least have the courage to Jonah to say, I think I'm the problem. The Bible says that they threw him overboard. In verse 17, the Lord prepared a great fish to swallow Jonah. And I said last week, and I firmly believe this, I believe that fish was specially ordered by God for that event. I do. And it served its purpose. Served its purpose. Let's go to chapter 2. So Jonah is swallowed by this great fish, and he's in this great fish for 3 days and three nights. How many have ever stayed in a horrible hotel one night? After reading this text, I'm like, man, that hotel wasn't half as bad as I thought it was. Because there ain't one of us here that had to spend 3 days and three nights inside of a fish. Jonah did. Now, there's a lot about Jonah that you might not know. And I had a number of people say, you know, that first chapter, that stuff you said, I had no idea was in the Bible. Because when we think of Jonah, we immediately think of the big fish, and that's all we think about. There's a lot going on in this man's life. So I've come up with a few facts, and I want to go over here, but I'm praying it's on here. Okay, there's the question. How about the answer? Number one, do you know that he was a citizen of the northern kingdom? I mentioned this. Okay, so the kingdom's cut in half. Judah's the southern kingdom. Israel's the northern kingdom. He was a prophet in Israel. That's the northern kingdom. Its capital was Samaria. All right, here's another fact about this man you might not know. All right, he wrote around 800 BC, which was a long time ago. But around 800 BC, Israel is being governed by Jeroboam, a wicked, wicked, wicked king. Assyria is where God wants Jonah to go, and the capital city of Assyria is Nineveh and preach repentance. It all took place around 800 BC. Just so you know, we can keep your time frame straight with what's going on. All right, number three. Jonah is the only minor prophet in whose career the miraculous plays such a prominent role. Now, I said minor prophet because if hey, there's a lot going on in Elijah's life. He was taken up into heaven and didn't die. Minor prophet. You know, Nahum, Habakkuk, those people whom you barely read about, they're all in the back end of the Old Testament. He is the only minor prophet whose career is defined by an incredible, miraculous act or role. Number four, Jonah's the only minor prophet whose major activity is on foreign soil. Because when God called his prophets to preach, it was usually in the homeland. All right, so it's either Judah or Israel. This time, God says, I want you to go to a foreign land and preach repentance. Why? God's not willing that what? Any should perish, but all should come to repentance. One reason why we have a very active missions program here, 10% of everything we take in goes to missions, is because we believe we have a responsibility to reach this community, but also God's not willing that people in Haiti, Pakistan, Myanmar, anywhere else perish. That's why we encourage you to give. Because if the general fund giving stinks, then our missions giving stinks. If we can stay on budget, and I want to congratulate this church, because over the last 4 weeks, the giving has been off the charts. Now, don't get excited. Don't get crazy on me. Everybody giving, right? Everybody carrying their load, all right? Because we believe even people on foreign soil need the gospel. All right, number five, real quick. He's the only prophet who preaches exclusively to foreign people. That's what he's known for. Going to foreign people and preaching. All right, number seven. The only Old Testament character represented as taking a trip on the Mediterranean Sea. And what a trip it was. All right, next. only Old Testament character to be mentioned by Jesus by name. Now, I find this interesting because I thought, well, a lot of people, theologians, these are people who are supposed to believe in the Bible, the whole Bible, the inerrancy of the whole Bible. They look at Jonah and go, this is fictitious. This didn't really happen. Now, I got to tell you something. If in the natural world, I find this crazy hard to believe. How about you? I mean, we've all told fish stories before. Hey, I reeled in a fish. It was this big. And everybody gets the picture, and it's this big. So we've all heard fish stories. This is the ultimate fish story. And I got to tell you something. When I read this story, I'm like, I can't even imagine a fish that big and to consume a human being and not like eat it, just rent out your intestines for 3 days, right? That's what happened. But here's how first of all, it's in the Bible, so I believe it. Number two, Jesus references it, Matthew 12:40. For as Jonah, as he's telling the Pharisees, the critics who are always picking on Jesus and trying to find anything that he would say that could not be authenticated, he alludes to Jonah, Matthew 12:40. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Do you realize that Jesus is equating Jonah's experience to his own death, burial, and resurrection? Do you think for a moment he would line up his own bodily resurrection with a story that was fictitious? I say no. Number eight, Jonah's the only Old Testament character likened by the Lord himself. And number nine, the book stresses universalism more than any other minor prophet. The fact that God wants the world to hear the good news. Biscuits are done. All right, I guess. He isn't, by the way, the only man or woman who, in receiving a command from God, ran the other way. That's why I relate to this text. Now, if we're only going to read it from a historical perspective, there was a guy who lived 800 BC who got on a boat and got thrown overboard and got eaten by a fish, whip-de-doo. Then you're going to walk out here and this sermon means nothing to you. But I'm going to tell you something. There are life-changing information that all of us can dial in to this text. Number one, don't forget, he isn't the only man or God, as I said earlier, who had a command to do something and ran from God. You know, we've got some folks right now, the Holy Spirit's tugging at your heart, man. This is the day of salvation. And you got to ask yourself this question. Are you going to run down this aisle today and put Jesus Christ on in Christian baptism? Or are you going to do just like Jonah, whoop, and go the other direction? We got some folks right now who have been praying every day for months. Lord, I need to get involved in a solid, spirit-filled recovery program. And every Monday at 6:30, we celebrate recovery in people's life. Now, you got to ask yourself a question today. Are you getting ready to run to the recovery program, or are you going to continue to run away? So he gets his marching orders from God, probably gets on a boat and heads the opposite direction. By the way, I threw that map up one more time. Notice I'm running. Okay. Whew, exercise is done for the week. All right, so here's where he's supposed to go, Nineveh. 500 miles, boom, boom. That's what he's supposed to do. Notice he does what? He goes 2,500 miles out of his way. Now, again, Tarshish is the city he's headed to. That's modern day what now? Spain. Now, see the direction? Supposed to go? Ran the other way. All right, so he makes a big mistake. Fails to follow his directions. Tunes out God's request. So God sends a storm. So what's he going to do now? Jonah 2:1, Jonah prays. Jonah prays. Can you say that with me? Jonah prays. Jonah prays. Folks, that's the first step to getting on the right page with God, is start communicating with him. Now, what's Jonah doing in the first chapter when he gets on the boat? The storm arises. Everybody's throwing cargo over. They're questioning whether they're going to survive. What's he doing? He's sleeping. But now he's praying. Someone once said, prayer is a conversation you have with God about things he can change. Worry is a conversation you have with yourself about stuff you simply cannot change. Do you realize that God has Jonah right where he wants him? There is not one thing this man can do to better his condition. There's not one thing he can do to better his condition except one thing. And that's the one thing he's finally doing, and that's having a heartfelt conversation with God. Listen, road to recovery starts with putting your phone down, starts with putting your computer away, and just having a heartfelt conversation with your Creator, because I'm telling you something, He wants to hear from you. Folks, the first step with getting right with God is communicating with Him. And that's what prayer is. It's a heartfelt conversation with God. Jonah's grand affliction led him to cry out to God. In verse 2, I cried out to the Lord because of my affliction. And when God heard me, the Bible says He answered him. Paul Butler writes, our Heavenly Father knows that we have need of chastening and of endurance. In fact, chastening, discipline, and endurance, listen to this, is the school wherein we're trained. It's the school that we get the best training. Our ability to grow and flourish spiritually generally happens when Jesus Christ disciplines us. I don't know why that's the case. My teacher used to beg me, look, Jim, I'm going to try to give you positive reinforcement. I'm like, whatever. But as soon as my dad threatened to whip me and was like, what's the next assignment? How far can I get ahead? Discipline. Sometimes it's the only thing we answer to. It's the only thing we respond to. And so, Paul Butler, you're right on, brother. Our Heavenly Father knows that. And He knows that we have need of chastening and of endurance. It's the school, it's the classroom wherein we're better trained. Hebrews 12:11. We can all relate to this. No discipline, the writer of Hebrews says, seems pleasant at the time. So I'm thinking of Jonah in the belly of the whale, and I'm thinking, is there anything, Jonah, anything that was going right for you right now? The smell must have been overwhelming. And you know he was nervous every time it was lunch, dinner, or breakfast time for this great fish, because he knows what that means. No discipline, Jonah, seems pleasant at the time, does it? It's very painful. We've all been on the end of God's discipline. It is painful. It's difficult. It's frustrating. Later on, the writer of Hebrews says, later on, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who've been trained by it. The Apostle Paul actually welcomed his own state of helplessness and his own state of hopelessness in 2 Corinthians, the first chapter. 2 Corinthians, the first chapter, we read these words. 2 Corinthians 1, 8 through 11, Paul writes, for we do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, of our troubles. You're writing to the church at Corinth here. These troubles came to us in Asia, that we were burdened beyond measure, above our own strength. We were even despairing of our own life. We thought our lives were going to end. Verse 9, yes, we had the sentence of death in ourselves. And I got to believe that in those 3 days and three nights that Jonah was in the belly of the whale, I'm sure he thought, this is how my life's going to end. This is it. There ain't no way out of here. Paul says, I'm right there with you. We thought our lives were going to end. But we didn't trust in ourselves, but we trusted in the God who raises the dead. So let me encourage you right now. If you can relate to both Paul and Jonah right now, and that's where you are. You've got health issues and like, man, I'm waiting for the doctor to lock in on what's going on with me. You know, I've got a distant relationship with my grandkids and my kids or my spouse. I go through my own feelings of despair. Trust issues from things that took place in my life so long ago that I had no control over. But Satan's always throwing that in my face. And you can dial into Jonah and Paul and go, man, I got you, man. I know what it's like to be in despair. But I also know it's not us or anyone else that can deliver me from this but you. And make that your prayer. Recognize that's why God wants to hear from you. That's why God desperately likes to hear from His people. Because we realize where from whence our help truly comes. Verse 10. Who delivered us from such a great death and does deliver us in whom we trust that He will still deliver us. Paul's like, man, we faced all kinds of adversity. But we woke up every day realizing that God delivers His people. Do you believe that today? I do. That's why I refuse to give up on the United States of America. As corrupt as our Congress and our executive office is, I still believe if God's people pray hard enough and work hard enough, He'll deliver this nation. I do. I believe that. The First Continental Congress was birthed out of a prayer service, for crying out loud. So I refuse to give up. I'm on a high right now. Jeanette and I found out a long time ago, but it's now. We're going to be grandparents. Yeah, man. We're going to be grandparents. How bad can life be, right? When you get to be a grandparent. I am so excited. March is going to come around. I'll be dancing on air. Woo-hoo. Just call me Papa from now on. I will not answer anything else. And I'll tell you something else. Macy and Cole lost their first baby. So we were all nervous. We didn't know what to do. We didn't know what to say. We just like pins and needles all through the first trimester. And then we realized, look, let's just turn this over to God. Let's just turn this over to God. We trust that He will deliver us. And He'll deliver you. Yeah. You say, man, I can relate to Jonah. Are you relating enough to pray like he did? Verse 11. You also helping together in prayer for us, and thanks may be given by many persons on our behalf. Everybody was praying for Paul, and he absorbed all those prayers. That's called intercessory prayer for the gift granted to us through many. The apostle Paul welcomed his state of helplessness because he knew God was in control. Jonah cries out to God, and what does God do? He answered me. Psalm 34:17 says, the Lord hears his people when they call to him for help, and he rescues them from all their troubles. Count on that, friends. He says, out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice. Like, Sheol, that's a Hebrew term. It's a Hebrew word for hell, the pit, and the grave. Now, I want to ask you a question. Is it safe to say that what is he's experiencing right now in Jonah 2 is as close to physical death as one could get without dying? And I'm going to tell you, the answer is yes. Now think about it. He's questioning whether or not he's ever going to see the light of day. In his mind, he has thought through the fact that this is where his life will end. And all he could do is think about the fact, I should have got on the other boat. I should have got on the other boat. I should have got on the other boat. Now remember, it's not just the belly of the fish. He had to survive a tumultuous storm, a near-drowning experience, because remember, they tossed him overboard, and you know he's looking for any flotation device he can get his hands on. And just when he thinks this giant piece of wood is floating by, it's like, finally, it's the biggest fish he's ever seen, and it opens up his mouth and eats him. He says, this is hell on earth. This is the pit. I'm in the grave. But I also know this. When you hit that low, there's only one way to look, and that's up. And that's exactly where God brings his people many times, to Sheol, the pit, the grave. Because now he's got our attention. You know, here's an interesting fact that I thought of when I was writing this sermon. Of all the different locations that God's men and women prayed. You know, because Bill just led us in a prayer this morning, and it's we do this every Lord's Day. And you're sitting in these chairs, and one of our elders is on stage, and we know it's a time of communication with God, and it's in this setting, which is great. But do you realize throughout the Bible, God's people prayed in many very different places? So Daniel prayed where? In a lion's den. Eli prayed in the temple. Jesus prayed in a garden. Mary and Rhoda prayed in their little apartment. All throughout the Bible, people praying in different places. Paul and Silas prayed in a jail cell. And yet, even though it was in a different place and usually birthed out of a travesty or a crisis, God heard them. Jonah takes full responsibility for his punishment. Verse 3, you cast me in the deep, in the heart of the seas. The flood surrounded me. All your billows and your waves passed over me. I'm here because I deserve it. I'm here because I failed you. Verse 4, he says, then I said, after I realized my sin, he goes, you know what? I've been cast out of your sight. Do you realize that more grievous than his experience in the belly of this great fish, he lamented this more than that. I am no longer in your will. Folks, that's what sin does, see. Sin separates us from the love of God. Sin separates us from the joys of service. Love separates us from the power of the Holy Spirit. Love. Now, when I say love of God, I want you to know God loves us unconditionally. But when we enter into a sinful lifestyle, our love for Him is severely tarnished. It is. And Jonah's sitting there in the belly of the whale, and he says, as bad as it is, being in this condition, in this environment. What's worse is my sin has caused me to be out of fellowship with you. Unrepentant sin does that. Here's my encouragement today. Don't read this story simply from a historical perspective. Listen, God's speaking through Jonah's experience to you and me right now, and everybody online. Listen carefully. Sin separates. I have been cast out of your sight, verse 4, and he says, yet, I will look again toward your holy temple. As much as I've disappointed you, Lord, I know I can look again to you for recovery. David alludes to this very feeling that the prophet Jonah's experienced in Psalm 51:10, creating me a clean heart, O God. Now, this is after an adulterous affair, after he had one of his top servicemen killed to cover up his crime. The baby that was born out of wedlock has died. I mean, one series of sins after the other. He's confronted by a preacher, falls on his face in repentance. In Psalm 51, he says, Lord, after all the things that I've done, please create in me a clean heart again. And please renew the spirit that I once had, a steadfast spirit. Don't cast me away from your presence, and please don't take your Holy Spirit from me. And I thought to myself, as much as David fears of the physical consequences of his actions, the thing that concerns him the most is that God would remove his Holy Spirit from him. Jonah says, the thing that bothers me the most about what I did, not the shipwreck, not the storm that I survived, not this big ugly fish I'm camping out in. It's the fact that I'm afraid that I've destroyed my relationship with you, God, because of this sin. Now listen carefully today. Everybody has to do some inventory. And you've got to ask yourself, and I've got to ask myself, God, is there a signature sin that I'm engaged in right now that is causing friction and eclipsing your power and your glory in my life? Do I feel like my presence with you has been tarnished and that the Holy Spirit is systematically being removed because of my unrepented sin? And if that's the case, I've got good news. While there is still daylight and while there is still time, which you have right now, you can change. You can make the same prayer that Jonah did. Admit you've messed up. I've been cast out of your sight. Yet, I know I can look again, verse 4, towards your holy temple. Paul Butler writes, one of the greatest paradoxes of God is that we have to die before we can live again. Isn't that a paradox? God says, I'm going to heal you. Great, but you've got to die first. You've got to die to sin to live. John 12:24-25, most assuredly I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and then dies, it remains all by itself alone. But when and if it dies, here's what you can count on. It will produce much grain. He who loves his life has to lose it. He who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternity. The prodigal son, classic example. That kid had to hit rock bottom. He was in a pigsty. They got Jonah in the belly of a whale. This guy's feeding pigs. When he was at his lowest, he said, you know what? It's time for me to go home. When he ran home, his dad had his arms open wide. I've said this before. You can walk a million miles away from God, but the journey back is one step. One step. One of my closest friends when I was in ministry at Winter Park was a guy named Jeff. Jeff graduated from Florida Christian College, one of the most intelligent, gifted students that school had ever graduated. He married one of the most beautiful young ladies at the school, flourishing ministry. His passion was campus ministry. We had started a campus ministry at UCF when Jeff was living in Florida. He applied for the job and got it, and I mean that ministry flourished. Over time, though, Jeff decided to sow some wild oats and begin living a lifestyle contrary, not to my commands, but contrary to God's, which now make them my worldview. He left his wife, left ministry, and began to hop from one gay bar to the next. And living out that lifestyle, and that if that wasn't bad enough, he began to engage in drug abuse and drug use, crystal meth, not only selling it, but I'm confident he was using it. And over time, we just lost track of Jeff. And one day, I pulled up to the property at Winter Park to go into my office, and this gentleman walked up to me and called me by name. And I absolutely had no idea who he was. No idea who he was. He was gaunt. He was sick. I thought, either this guy is getting ready to die, or he has spent 3 days and three nights in the belly of a giant fish. That's how bad Jeff looked. And I said, "Sir, can I help you?" He goes, "Jim, it's me." I said, "Man, help me out here." He said, "It's Jeff." And I almost fell over. I said, "Jeff, come into my office." And he said, "Jim, I want you to do me a favor. I don't want you to read any scripture to me. I know them by heart. I know my life, my choices are offending God." He said, "What I really need right now is a friend." I said, "Okay." But I said, "Tell you what, friend, I'm going to pray for you. And I'm going to pray like I've never prayed for you." He left. A few months later, Jeff called me and said, "Jim, I need your help." He said, "My roommate is up at the hospital and he's dying of AIDS. He said, I want you to go up there with me. And I want you to help me share the gospel of Jesus Christ with him." I said, "I'll meet you there." We got there. We had to be very careful because his mother was there, and she had no idea of what really was going on. And so we prayed with him, and I walked out of the hospital room. I said, "Jeff, listen to me. You got to come back up here. And you got to make sure that your friend is in a right relationship with Jesus Christ, because he's getting ready to step out into eternity." A day later, Jeff went back on his own and had prayer with his friend, recognized that his friend had surrendered his life to Christ at one time in Christian baptism, but because of his life choices and his decisions, he had drifted away. And they prayed the prayer of repentance. A day later, that man died. So after he passed away, Jeff said, "I need to talk." I said, "Yeah, we do." And I sat down at a Starbucks restaurant on Lakemont Avenue, and I looked Jeff in the eye and I said, "I'm not the smartest guy in the world, but I know enough to know if your friend passed away because of AIDS, what makes you sure that you're not going to go that same direction because of the choices you've made?" Jeff agreed it was time to move out of Central Florida because of the community was treacherous on his life and his choices. He moved to a sister congregation that had a Celebrate Recovery ministry, got heavily involved. That preacher took him under his wing. Eventually, Jeff moved to the coast and began working in a high-end counseling service with a faith-based initiatives throughout the entire program. And then Jeff began to post pictures of him baptizing businessmen in the ocean for the forgiveness of their sins. Jeff's married now with two beautiful children. It would not have happened had he, like the prodigal son and Jonah the prophet, spent days in Sheol, the pit, the grave, hell itself. I say that story unapologetically because I want those of you in the audience here and those watching online to know this. There is a God. He loves each and every one of you. And I've said this before, and I'll say it again unapologetically. If you decide you want to go to hell, you have to crawl over the broken body of Jesus Christ and an old rugged cross and an empty grave to get there. Verse 7. "When my soul fainted within me, I remembered you, Lord." For every parent out there that has a child that's gone astray, remember this: the seeds that you planted, they haven't forgotten. Jonah says, you know what, Lord? It took me to be here to remember you. Just when I thought my life was over and there was no hope, I remembered you. Verse 8 and 9, those who regard worthless idols forsake their own mercy. Those who give themselves over to the secular, who think that monetary goods and the world around them can save them, Jonah says, listen, they're forsaking the one who can really bring them mercy. And Jonah really thought that that boat that was going to Spain could save him. He's like, you know what? I realized it's your mercy that saves, not that boat, not running the other direction. But I will sacrifice to you. You know what, Lord? It's not my will, it's yours. You got my attention, God. You got my attention. So with a heart of thanksgiving, and I always find it interesting that Jonah says with the voice of thanksgiving, I'm like, Jonah, don't lie to me. Do not lie to us. This prayer is prayed from your heart. You're anguished, but ain't no way you're praying with a heart of thanksgiving. And Jonah says, no, you don't understand, Jim. Yes, I am. With a voice of thanksgiving, I will pay what I have vowed. I will honor God's request because I know that if I'm going to get out of this fish and I'm going to get saved, salvation comes from the Lord. I can't save myself. The prodigal son could not save himself. Jeffrey could not save himself. None of us can save ourselves. It is the grace and the mercy of Jesus Christ that saves. Favor we get that we just don't deserve. And then verse 10, here it is. The Lord spoke to the fish. And how many times wish you could speak to a fish and get on your hook, right? He spoke to the fish. And that big old fish vomited Jonah on dry land. You know, there's not many times in life we get a big time do-over, is there? But Jonah got a big time do-over here. It's by the grace of God that many marriages, even here today, had an opportunity to start over again. And you're taking full advantage of that, praise God. Some folks have abused their bodies with alcohol and drugs, received a new liver or new organ, a new lung transplant. Guess what? They're getting to do it all over again by the mercy and grace of Jesus Christ. And if you're here today and you're thinking that you don't deserve a second chance from God, I think it's important to remember you didn't deserve the first chance either. He gave that to you. Bottom line, Jonah sinned. He recognized the error of his way. He reached out to the only one who could save him and forgive him and give him another opportunity to get it right. And he did. Here's my question. Are you ready to get right with God today? Our Father in heaven, as we conclude this message and now transition into a song of invitation, if there's anyone in this room that's running from you, I pray that today they'll run to you. That's what chapter 2 is all about. Jonah running to you. And I know, Lord, sometimes in order to get our attention, you have to discipline us. We got to hit rock bottom in order to finally realize that we cannot lean on our own understanding, but in all of our ways acknowledge you and let you direct our path. That's what Jonah did, and I'm praying today that we will. God, the plan of salvation is relatively simple. By faith, believe that Jesus Christ died. Confess the name of Jesus, that he is the Christ, the Son of God. Making a willful decision to repent of our sins and turn away from unrighteousness and our wickedness and ask for another opportunity to get it right with your help. And then today, be baptized into Christ for the forgiveness of those sins, Lord, and to begin a journey serving you every day. God, I don't know if there's anybody here that needs to make that decision, but I've rarely been in this pulpit and not somebody in this audience that needs to do this. And I pray that if this is the day of salvation, I pray that they will respond. I thank you for do-overs. I really do, God. You are so gracious. Your mercies are renewed every day, every day. This morning, we get to do it over again. And then tomorrow, we're going to do it all over again. We're going to seek your mercies and your forgiveness because they're new every day. The only people that can experience that, those are those who are in your family, those who are saved. I pray, Father, that this will be the hour of salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand as we sing.
There are so many incredible lessons we can learn from the book, from the life of Jonah, and some of them we talked about today. The mystery that God created an incredible fish to swallow Jonah, that mystery is so incredible. The mystery of God's unconditional love, that he would send a prophet to a people that were not following God, that were far, far away from God, the mystery of God's unconditional love. We're going to sing a new song as we share in community today. It's new to us. It's not new, but it's a wonderful modern hymn, and it just talks about the wondrous mystery of all that God is, all that Jesus is. Every Sunday when we share in communion, we're reminded of the mystery of God in the flesh giving his life on the cross for us, for me, taking on my sin, that incredible mystery of how good, of how much God loves us. You're going to be dismissed row by row, and you can bring your offering to the trays. Collect your communion elements and go back to your seat. Have a time of meditation. Those in the balcony, the communion elements are on the tables as you walk in the doors. The drop boxes are for your offering. I know we have first-time guests here. We're so glad you're here. Let me explain how we do communion. In each slot on the communion trays, there are two cups. Please take both of them. The top cup contains the juice. The bottom cup contains the bread. And as we share in communion today, we're going to think about the mystery of God, mystery of God in the flesh, the mystery of the Son of God hanging on the cross because of his incredible love, and the mystery that God raised him up on the third day, and that Jesus Christ is coming back for his bride. Let's sing, "Come Behold the Wondrous Mystery," as we share in communion today.
In the dawning of the King.
want to remind you some great things coming up for Life the Church family. On Wednesday, electives are back in session. I know we had to take a little break this past Wednesday because of the storm that rolled through. So they're back in session on Wednesday night. Please come. They're incredible classes. On Saturday, it's a great day. Men's breakfast at 8 in the morning, and then Jim's American Heritage class is later that morning. So know that those are two great things going on Saturdays. Family Game Night is coming up on Friday, September 15th. Got any questions, call the church office. Ask to speak to Jim Mellenbacher about that. And then a Wings Widows Ministry event is happening on Saturday, September 16th. Got any questions about that, call the church office or see Sandy Chesser. Thanks for coming today. Hope you were encouraged in your walk with the Lord. What a great sermon series, The Life of Jonah. First time guests, thank you so much for joining us. Hope you were encouraged today, that you'll come back and worship with us again. Those of you watching online, thanks. Hope that you were encouraged. Let's stand. Going to sing a little bit of Battle Belongs as we leave today. Sweet.